Blackstone Audio presents Cast of Characters, Wolcott Gibbs, E.B. White, James Thurber, and the Golden Age of the New Yorker, by Thomas Vinciguerra. This book is read by Tony Pasqualini. For Robert Collins Christopher and Judith Crist. Preface: A Christmas Greeting to the New Yorkers. A cat may look at a king, I'm told, so perhaps a poet may make so bold as to send a greeting on evergreen to the staff of her favorite magazine, and hearty as bells in a country steeple say Glad Noel to the following people. To Mr. Ross, whom of course I'm able to feature only as myth, as fable, as an awesome figure I'll never see, an editorial deity. To Mr. Gibbs, who with consternation surveys my various punctuation. To Mr. Mosher, whom I have yet to pay a cherished and certain debt to, since he was the first to assure me, sighing, I might write verse if I kept on trying. To E.B. White, who was one time haughty because I envied the literati, and would have kept me, I greatly fear, with Ivanhoe and the young idea. To Mr. Thurber, another myth, but one I'm better acquainted with, and of course to the lady of my delight, the small, superlative Mrs. White. To them, and anyone else I've missed, from a somewhat extemporaneous list, I send my greetings, as note above, and my ardent but perfectly proper love. May the new year bring you a lot of things, like pictures funny as little kings, and writers writing hilarious stories, and scribes acquainted with Gotham mores. For talk of town, a thousand thoughts, and never a one about clever tots, and not too many about their mamas, light verse poets who know their commas, millions and millions of new subscribers, a host of fans and a dearth of jibers, no libel actions with which to cope, printers infallible as the Pope. And for shouts and murmurs, O precious store, one joke that's never been heard before. Ladies and gentlemen, all the staff, of my Christmas wishes that's only half. For you all blessings and none sent thinly is the holiday hope of Phyllis McGinley, signed 1934. Introduction. Either competent or horrible. The tensions of the summer of 1958 were in many ways typical of the ostensible peace that had followed the worst war in human history. In July, a bloody coup killed the king, crown prince, and premier of Iraq's pro-Western government, prompting the United States to send troops to Lebanon and Great Britain to do the same in Jordan. Hungary executed its former premier, Imre Nagy, 2 years after he had been kidnapped during the 1956 revolution. In Cuba, Fidel Castro continued to make inroads against the military government of Fulgencio Batista. Within a few months, he would triumph completely and establish the first communist foothold in the Americas. The space race was well underway, with Sputnik 3 and Explorer 1 whirling about just beyond the atmosphere, raising the terrifying specter of orbiting H-bombs. If there was a refuge from these and myriad other concerns, foreign and domestic, it could be found on Fire Island. Local vacationers had tentatively established the first permanent communities on this narrow, fragile barrier beach just south of Long Island in the late 1800s. Now the rhythms of the place were as reliable as the calendar. For 9 months of the year, Fire Island was home to a mere handful of hardy souls. During the winter, they might subsist only on fish and potatoes. Periodically, they were cut off from the rest of the world by the ice that would choke the waters of the Great South Bay. But from Memorial Day to Labor Day, the population swelled to thousands of summer people in search of respite from hot apartments, torpor, and for the men anyway, their workaday routine. For those with money and inclination, it was a temporary semblance of heaven on earth. One writer would rhapsodize. I guess I really like it here better than any place in the world, he thought. And for the moment, his delight in Fire Island, in this one place where life could be slowed to the almost forgotten tempo of childhood, seemed as much as he could bear. The distance from New York, by train and boat, was only 50 terrestrial miles, but in spirit it was enormous. You ate and slept in the dark, untidy little houses that lay along the dunes, between the sea and the bay, but most of your life was spent on the loveliest beach in the east, a narrow, sunny shelf that ran 30 miles along the Atlantic, from Babylon to Quag. And here you just lay in the sun, and all the staggering complexity of your relations with others, the endless, hopeless bookkeeping of your personal morality with too many people, could be put aside for a little while. It was a state of wonderful irresponsibility, a time in which you belonged to nobody but yourself, on which there were no immediate claims from the world. The author of this deeply felt passage, Oliver Wolcott Gibbs, was at first glance hardly the rusticating type. Most of his professional life had been spent on the staff of The New Yorker, which, for much of the literate reading public, was the last word in smart, urbane journalism. Founded by Harold Ross 33 years before, the weekly magazine, filled with rollicking prose and humorous drawings, quickly came to epitomize cynical, bustling Manhattan. Its writers, artists, and editors had thumbed their noses at Prohibition and roared their way through the last half of the 1920s. Then the existential challenges of the Depression, World War II, and ultimately the Cold War deepened and broadened the magazine's outlook. As worldly as Fire Island was sleepy, The New Yorker was now a national and international forum for masterful fiction, factual reporting, penetrating poetry, and astute criticism. Its contributors were university professors and Pulitzer Prize winners, their work setting ever higher standards for American letters. Gibbs had been a major part of that effort almost from the beginning. Joining the magazine as a copy reader in 1927, he quickly graduated to writing short comic sketches and line editing. Soon he was dashing off deft short stories and proving so good an editor that he came to specialize in spoofing the work of others. A contributor to the magazine's lead section of...
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.